Good afternoon. We begin this afternoon's business with portfolio questions. Question number one, Lewis Macdonald.
Thank you very much. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has carried out of public support for a second referendum on Scotland leaving the UK.
Minister Michael Russell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The current Scottish Government was elected last year with the largest ever constituency vote since the beginning of devolution on a clear manifesto pledge that the Scottish Parliament should have the right to hold another referendum if there was significant and material change in the circumstances that prevailed in 2014, such as Scotland being taken out of the EU against our will. That specific material change is now taking place. We believe the people of Scotland should therefore have the final choice over their future once the terms of Brexit are clear.
Lewis Macdonald.
I take it from that answer that the government has carried out no assessment of public attitudes to this matter since the Brexit referendum on the 23rd of June. Has the minister considered the opinion poll evidence summed up by Professor John Curtis in a blog on the 2nd of March, which is that Scottish voters are overwhelmingly opposed to a second independence referendum before the final outcome of Brexit negotiations is clear? Does he not agree that the priority for the Scottish Government for the next 2 years should be to protect Scotland's vital interests in those negotiations and to secure the repatriation of powers over devolved areas from Brussels to Holyrood, rather than promoting a further referendum which the Scottish people do not want?
Minister.
Well, of course, those two objectives are not mutually contradictory. Indeed, I received a letter from David Davis this very day that looked forward to working together on some of the issues that lay ahead. So the member is wrong about that matter. He's also wrong about opinion poll evidence. It shows to be about 50-50 in those circumstances. But there are very clear indications of public support available often in the opinion polls. I draw attention to those opinion polls which show the Labour Party to be in third place in Scotland. That is an indication of public support for Lewis Macdonald, his point of view, and the Labour Party.
Gillian Martin. Point of order, Mr. Donald.
I assume that Mr. Russell has inadvertently confused my question about support for holding a referendum with a different question about support for independence. Would he care to correct the record at this point?
No.
That's not a point of order, Mr. Macdonald, but the point has been noted, I'm sure, by the Minister. Gillian Martin.
Does the Minister think that the opposition telling us, both sides of the opposition telling us to spend parliamentary time discussing health and education, and then at the very first opportunity, using portfolio questions to talk about independence, is a little bit hypocritical?
Yep. Yes.
Minister.
An acute point as ever from the member. I have to make the point, of course, that the Scottish Government will.
Order, please. It's all very amusing, but order, please. Minister.
Well, some people are easily amused, Presiding Officer, quite clearly. The reality of the situation, of course, is that the parliamentary time that this government uses is used to further the interests of Scotland in many different ways. And that is shown by the record of achievement the government has had over the past 10 years, which is considerable and growing. I know that makes opposition parties uncomfortable, but the Scottish National Party in government has been efficient and effective and will continue to be so. I would suggest that the leader of the opposition, whoever the opposition is these days, because it seems to be only a united opposition, the leader of the opposition and indeed the Prime Minister should get back to their day jobs and start to concentrate on the real issues that are facing Scotland, like being dragged out of Europe against our will.
Adam Tompkins.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. If I can ask a supplementary question about the Constitution in portfolio questions on the Constitution. To propose another referendum in the next Parliament without strong evidence that a significant number of those who voted no have changed their minds would be wrong and we won't do it, unquote. Or again, if I, the SNP, those who believe in independence can't shift opinion from September 2014, we won't earn the right to ask the question. Again, both direct quotations from the First Minister. Was she wrong? Or if she wasn't wrong, why have ministers changed their minds?
The member knows very well that, and I read it in my original answer, so clearly he was not listening. The manifesto in which the First Minister stood, I stood, everybody on this side of the chamber stood, says, if there is significant material change in the circumstances that prevailed in 2014, such as Scotland being taken out of the EU against our will. He has clearly seen what has been taking place today. He has clearly seen the attitude of the Prime Minister. In all those circumstances, that manifesto commitment has been fulfilled and will be followed. Secondly, Presiding Officer, I'd make this point. It is a very dangerous position for any opposition to believe that they can veto a majority in the Parliament based upon a manifesto commitment. That is not democracy. And those who choose to depart from that cannot be, by definition, Democrats.
Question number two, Claudia Beamish.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to concerns that reductions in local government budgets will have a negative impact on local services in South Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary Derek Mackay.
Scotland's local authorities will have an extra £383 million to support local services in 2017-18, which represents an increase of 3.7% compared to this year. This should have a positive impact on local services all over Scotland, including the south of Scotland.
Indeed. Claudia Beamish.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, but the sorts of cuts that are happening from the Scottish Government to our local services are absolutely mind-boggling, frankly, with hundreds of millions from the Scottish Government being cut to local services since 2011. And while I thank the Minister for the answer, I'd like to know what assessment has been done of the impact on third sector organisations who are finding their funding reduced as a result of budget cuts to local services. For instance, in my region, the Lanarkshire Carers Centre have approached me about their funding position, and NHS Lanarkshire, they have approached me and they have great concerns, actually, Minister. NHS Lanarkshire, a contributor, perhaps you'd like to hear the question.
Excuse me, order please. Minister, through the
NHS
chair,
NHS Lanarkshire, Claudia a contributor, Beamish. Has confirmed with me that they are unable to continue the top-up funding which was previously done. 2016-17 funding is honoured, but beyond this it's uncertain. And in addition, as the Scottish Government money is only announced in relation to carers on an annual basis, long-term planning is challenging. And similar issues have been raised by Borders Care Voice Forum. So I would like to know what assessment's been done about the impact of Scottish Government cuts on local services and particularly on the third sector.
Cabinet Secretary.
But I tried to make the point to Claudia Beamish for the interests of the Chamber as well that we've actually increased the resources for local services across. And I've checked beyond the point I've made around wider local services, which does include health and social care integration, but specifically all the local authorities in the south of Scotland region. And every single local authority that I've looked at will have an increase in total funding. And I say that separating out health and social care. I see Claudia Beamish shaking her head, so I'll give her the figures for each council. Dumfries and Galloway, an increase of 4.1%. East Ayrshire, an increase of 4.9%. East Lothian, an increase of 5.3%. Mid Lothian, an increase of 4.2%. Scottish Borders Councils, an increase of 5%. South Ayrshire Council, an increase of 3.8%. And South Lanarkshire, an increase of 2.7%. Of course, it is a matter of local choice as to how local authorities spend those resources, but the budget has approved specific sums to tackle, for example, attainment. And in relation to third sector, I've gone out my way to try and protect third sector functions and budgets through the course of the budget. And of course, there will be analysis of the impacts of our spending decisions, but reflect once again on the fact that we have increased, and yes, through the cooperation and support of the Greens as well, to increase the total resource to local government in what was quite a challenging settlement. But essentially, I think that the partnership arrangements that we have, no local authority rejected the financial settlement I gave to them. I worked constructively with COSLA. They recognised the movement on the part of the government. And as well as all of that, local authorities had the ability to raise the council tax up to a level of 3%, which many chose to do, but many local authorities did not. Maybe Claudia Beamish should ask some local authorities why they chose not to increase the council tax to invest in the exact kind of services that Claudia Beamish said she was concerned about.
Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The south of Scotland is crying out for funds to improve its roads. And recently I wrote to the Scottish Borders Council and was told that there is a long list of identified projects, many of which are classed as high priority. Unfortunately, over recent years, the priorities from other sectors have meant a significant downturn in the number of road improvements being undertaken. This has further been exacerbated by reducing revenue budgets and a deteriorating asset base that leads to an increasing higher percentage of investment going on maintaining the existing asset rather than actual improvements. When will the Scottish Government adequately support our local authorities to improve our local roads?
Well, first of all, I'd like to point out to to the member that in the budget we actually increased roads maintenance and the Conservatives voted against it through the course of Scottish budget. But it really is quite rich of the Conservatives. I have to say to the Labour Party, at least with some credibility, maybe not with every local authority, but with some credibility you can argue you wanted extra investment in public services because you proposed to put up all levels of tax, including basic rate tax. That's not a choice that we made, but at least with some credibility the Labour Party can say that they wanted to invest those increased taxes into more public services. The Conservatives, however, proposed tax cuts for the richest individuals, richest businesses, and richest in terms of value of house and the transaction tax therein. So the Tories really can't speak with any credibility when they call for extra resources into local services, especially having opposed increased budgets that this government proposed, particularly around maintenance and investment, which was the area that Rachel Hamilton asked me about.
Question three, Joanne Lamond.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment has made of the local government budget allocation to Glasgow since 2007.
Cabinet Secretary.
All of Scotland's 32 local authorities have received their fair formula share of the funds provided through the annual local government finance settlement as agreed with COSLA. Glasgow City Council will continue to receive the highest level of local government funding per head of all wholly mainland councils in 2017-18.
Anne Lamond.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response? The Cabinet Secretary is aware, of course, that his government has cut Glasgow's budget by £377 million since 2007. Does the Cabinet Secretary recognise the important work of Glasgow Labour Council in doing its best to protect frontline services, leading the way in supporting childcare and apprenticeships, and making Glasgow a leading centre for business, tourism and sport? Does the Cabinet Secretary further acknowledge the critical role of Glasgow to the economy of Scotland? And in those circumstances, does the Cabinet Secretary therefore regret the opportunities lost, the families unsupported, and the economy benefit lost directly by his government's choice, the price to be paid by every Glaswegian for his choice to cut rather than fund services?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I actually begin with recognising some of those points? Actually, the areas that have been identified, I would welcome as the City Council addresses key issues in the city. I would welcome any administration to focus on those. And there have actually been good areas of partnership working between Scottish Government and City of Glasgow Council. I was a signatory on behalf of the Government for the City Deal proposition as well. So I think there are many areas in which we've been able to work in partnership with the City Council. Not always found every area to be of agreement, but there are many areas of partnership and shared endeavour, not least around deprivation, inequality, the need for further economic development and partnership, as I say, that we've taken together. But again, it would be wrong to suggest that the overall spending power of the City Council has decreased. Again, as a consequence of the budget, Glasgow City Council's overall increase in spending power to support local authority services in 17-18 will amount to over a £45 million increase, and that's 3.3%. Now, I hear Joanne Lamont complaining about the settlement, but I would gently say, although it's a matter for local authorities, if they want to suggest changes to the distribution formula, I'm open to discussion on that via COSLA. But of course, since this is the day of exits, I would remind the Labour Party that Glasgow City Council Labour Administration walked away from COSLA. Yeah. Now, surely it's in the interests of all the people of the city to participate in COSLA, who negotiates with government on matters such as finance, the budget and the settlement and distribution thereof. So I would encourage the Labour Party to think very deeply about their position as we enter local government elections, about local government frankly being stronger if the 32 local authorities are willing to engage with us together in partnership. So once again, it's an increased settlement, strong partnership working on areas of joint endeavour. City Deal is all about economic development, but I would encourage the Labour Party to think about their engagement with COSLA going forward so that we can have further discussions about distribution. And finally, I would say again, just as the Tories opposed increased investment on roads maintenance and then called for more, the Labour Party asked for increased investment in attainment, really important for education and tackling the attainment gap in Glasgow, and the Labour Party voted against that when push came to shove at stage three in the budget.
John Mason.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. When I look at the per capita budget allocations by authority, and when you take away the four island authorities, the three remaining, if Joanne Lamont will allow me, the three remaining with the greatest per head is Glasgow Inverclyde and West Dumbarton, which strikes me as good because they are the ones with great needs in the west of Scotland. And will the government commit to continuing, as it has done, to well fund such needy authorities?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think it is very important that there are different elements, of course, to the complex nature of local government funding. But fundamentally, the needs-based assessment is a feature that has been agreed with local government through COSLA and does distribute on the basis of need. And that's why local authorities like Glasgow feature so highly when it comes to the distribution of that resource. And it is important to tackle need and make sure there is that level of redistribution. And again, the Labour Party has not been consistent on this, because if you speak to the Labour Party in, for example, Aberdeen, the finance convener there, Willie Young, says that, you know, Aberdeen's money has been ripped off and sent to places like Glasgow. In Glasgow, the Labour Party say that their money has been sent elsewhere. In truth, the formula, whilst it may not be perfect, but it's the best we've got, I'm willing to engage with local authorities, and I do believe in the needs-based assessment to ensure that resources are directed on the basis of that need.
Question number four, Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how its national digital strategy will impact on the constituency of Motherwell and Wishaw.
Cabinet Secretary.
Realising Scotland's full potential in a digital world is a strategy for all of Scotland that aims to build a vibrant, inclusive and outward-looking nation with a successful digital economy, comprehensive access to connectivity and an education system focused on digital skills. And the strategy was published on the 22nd of March.
Claire Adamson.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer? Motherwell and Wishaw has unique post-industrial challenges. While we have a wonderful college in New College Lanarkshire, we also have one of the biggest brownfield sites in Europe. What investment potential does the Cabinet Secretary envisage for Motherwell and Wishaw under this new strategy?
Cabinet Secretary.
The strategy covers a number of areas, including skills and connectivity, the potential of growth, employment, as well. And more physically, when we're dealing with the connectivity challenge, we've got very ambitious targets around that. But if we then take that to areas of both deprivation and dereliction, then I think it should tie up with other strategies, such as through the Vacant and Derelict Land Fund, to be able to bring together the kind of softer interventions we're making with actual physical structure. And therefore, there are resources that are available to Lanarkshire to be able to invest in those kind of sites. And I'd absolutely commend the work that the college is doing and education and the potential there is around skills and the new funding announced as part of this. It should all come together to help areas such as the constituencies.
Question five, Graeme Dey.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what the impact will be of the Finance Secretary's recent announcement of £15.6 million being reinvested back into the Digital Scotland programme.
Cabinet Secretary.
An additional 17,000 homes and businesses across 27 local authorities will benefit from fibre broadband as a result of the £15.6 million gainshare investment being made through the Digital Scotland contract covering the rest of Scotland region. This is in addition to the £2.2 million of gainshare funding announced by the Highlands and Islands Enterprise last year, which will deliver fibre broadband connectivity to additional 1,800 premises across the Highlands and Islands region.
Graeme Dey.
Thank you. In announcing the additional funding, the Cabinet Secretary said it would have a particular focus on maximising the number of premises that have access to speeds of greater than 24 megabits, with funding targeted on areas with the lowest speed coverage, including Angus. Can I ask if there are any specific plans as yet for my constituency of Angus South and whether the Scottish Government would be prepared to work in collaboration with Angus Council on this?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I do believe there is potential to do that, but we've set out our ambitious targets, including coverage of 100% of homes and businesses by 2021. We're very much on track to achieve the milestones of our targets. But this particular initiative should benefit an additional 500 premises in Angus, ensure that we roll out superfast broadband through that particular challenge, and it will increase superfast broadband coverage in Angus to 91.2% by the end of the Digital Scotland rollout, and then, as I say, move on to our much more ambitious target of 100% coverage.
Jamie Green.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary just to clarify a point on this additional funding? Is it not the case that actually this money is the result of a clawback clause in the contract with BT and is actually not new additional money being provided by the Scottish Government?
I didn't say that it was Scottish Government money. I think I was very clear in making the original announcement how it is part of the contract at where BT has been involved in an area, it hits certain targets, that money is provided and then released, and then there's that dialogue about how it's distributed. So I suppose what I'm highlighting is how it's benefiting communities that otherwise wouldn't have that connectivity. I welcome the approach, I welcome the intervention. I've tried to raise awareness of it. I appreciate members asking questions of it, and would encourage members who are interested to look at the website, www.scotlandsuperfast.com. So putting it into context, just one of our many interventions to reach our target of 100% coverage by the end of this parliament. And I fully recognise that there will need to be new technologies, different ways of procuring the services to reach that ambitious target. This is just one. But I've never pretended that it was Scottish Government money, but absolutely there's Scottish Government involvement in the contracts, and I'm happy to confirm that to the member.
We move from finance and constitution to economy, jobs and fair work questions. Question number one from Fulton MacGregor.
Thank you, President Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to boost the economy and create jobs and cope bridging crisis.
Minister Paul Wheelhouse.
Our enterprise and skills agencies are working to deliver sustainable, inclusive economic growth across Scotland, including in times such as Coatbridge and Cryston. By promoting Scotland as an attractive place for business and innovation, and through our substantial investment in infrastructure, regeneration, skills, internationalisation and business support. The Scottish Investment Bank has also directly supported 8 investment projects in North Lanarkshire, while Scottish Enterprise currently account manages 167 companies in the local authority area. And BioCity at Newhouse was designated as Life Sciences Enterprise Area in April 2016. The competitiveness of Coatbridge and Cryston as a business location will be enhanced by the £500 million upgrade to the M8, M73 and M74 that will reduce traffic congestion, while the Scottish Government has delivered a highly competitive business environment with a reduced poundage on business rates and premises with a rateable value under £15,000 now qualifying for 100% business rates relief through the small business bonus policy, with those between £15,000 and £18,000 rateable value benefiting from a 25% discount on rates.
Fulton MacGregor.
I thank the Minister for that response. Coatbridge Town Centre has suffered multiple setbacks recently, including closure of 2 banks, proposed closure of the DWP processing unit, and some major fires in some of the empty buildings. People are rightly concerned about the future of their main street. Having hosted a well-attended public meeting recently, I am in the process of establishing a steering group involving residents and businesses to create and implement a plan to improve the town centre. Would the Minister be willing to meet with the steering group to discuss how the Scottish Government could support the regeneration of Coatbridge Town Centre and create more jobs locally?
Minister.
Well, on the latter point, certainly I'd be happy to meet with Mr MacGregor's constituents to discuss how we can help support regeneration within the community. I certainly would commend, I've seen efforts elsewhere across Scotland where similar initiatives of taking a grassroots approach, looking at how communities can help develop a vision for their community. I've been very successful not only in developing a plan which a local authority can then take forward, but also helping to support subsequent funding applications to lottery and other good causes to support projects locally. What I would say is that to help Mr MacGregor, I'll provide further detail on this, but the Government has also taken forward the Town Centre First principle with the local Government trying to encourage any investment decisions made by public authorities and indeed to secure private sector investment in town centres to identify if that could be the best location first and then only looking at peripheral areas thereafter to try and drive more footfall into our town centres and support local businesses. But I'm happy to meet with the member and his constituents and to provide further detail to him.
Richard Leonard.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. The Minister will be aware of representations that I've made to save the jobs at the tannoy factory in the town of Coatbridge. The GMB union, the workforce and Scottish Enterprise have been actively working to secure these jobs for Lanarkshire, but all too often have been kept in the dark by the owner of the factory based in the Philippines. And despite their valiant efforts, many of the workers are facing redundancy at the end of this week. So can I ask, even at this stage, that the Cabinet Secretary himself makes personal direct contact and representations to the owner of the company in Manila?
Minister.
Well, I'd like to reassure Mr. Leonard that I, on behalf of the government, have been active involved, as the Cabinet Secretary, in looking at the case involving tannoy. We're obviously very concerned at loss of any jobs, but I would reassure the member that the company have been engaging with government and Scottish Enterprise on proposals to develop new capacity in relation to a specific project, which I'm not at liberty to disclose, but we are hopeful that there will be some jobs retained within the area in due course. I can investigate the matter about the communication with the trade union. That's obviously not entirely within our gift, but we will certainly encourage the company, if we can do, to engage with the trade union, because clearly we want to ensure that those who are affected are kept informed of what is happening. But I would reassure the member that there are encouraging discussions around retaining some employment in the area.
Question number two, Tom Arthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I refer members to my register of interest and my professional background in music to ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the economic contribution of the music industry.
Cabinet Secretary Keith Brown.
The music industry in Scotland is a key part of our thriving creative industries sector. Scottish Government growth sector statistics show that in 2014, the music industry in Scotland had a turnover of £27.9 million and a GVA of £15.5 million. Moreover, the 2016 UK Music Report, Wish You Were Here, showed that music festivals and live concerts attracted 928,000 music tourists to Scotland in 2015. These visitors generated £295 million for the local economy and also helped sustain 3,230 full-time jobs across the nation.
Come on, Arthur.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Every musician, the overwhelming majority of musicians, are self-employed. The emerging phenomena of the precariat in the gig economy are conditions long known to people operating in music. And can I ask, in light of the Cabinet Secretary's answer, if he agrees with me that it's vital that we continue to nurture musical talent in Scotland and to provide the support and mentoring needed to encourage people, young people, to pursue a career in our growing and ever more exciting music industries?
Cabinet Secretary.
I do agree with the member, and I also think it's true to say that we have to make more of the contribution that the creative arts make to the economy, actually to increase that contribution, but to recognise the current contribution that's there. And it's very important that we support young people to learn music and to pursue musical careers through the Youth Music Initiative, which has received funding of £109 million since 2007 and is delivered by Creative Scotland. The Youth Music Initiative provides a range of music-making opportunities for young people of all ages. It gives them a chance to try new music-making activities in their area to begin their musical journey or to build on their existing experiences. And earlier this month, the Cabinet Secretary for Culture also spoke at a Scottish Music Industry Day at Glasgow University to promote career opportunities in the industry.
Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We should be rightly proud of new and emerging talent, like constituents of mine, the Ayoub Sisters, who recently were nominated for the Young Scot Award and who will be performing in Parliament later this year. They've got some great songs, it's well worth a listen. What steps is the Scottish Government taking to support a broad range of musical talent and genres in order to help grow the economy?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I look forward to the performance which has been referred to, and I'm sure it will be excellent. Considering other support which the Scottish Government can bring, we have the regularly funded music portfolio, and our thinking has been framed by a 10-year plan, including the music sector review and the music companion piece. I agree with Maurice Golden, there is some huge talent that we should support. I have to say, in my own household, I actively support a budding musician, and he takes a lot of support to do that. But I think it's very interesting to see that... Well, I have to be fair, he also works part-time at Asda to help sustain himself as well. But I think it's very important. And I think what I have seen in recent years, and I don't know whether Maurice Golden would agree, that compared to Ireland, which is a very vibrant live music scene, I think we've started to see much more of that taking place in Scotland. It is to be encouraged, and perhaps the best way we can encourage it is by each of us attending events like that and supporting the artists who are involved in those.
Question number three, David Stewart.
Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what action it's taking to support Dingwall's economy.
Minister Paul Wheelis.
Dingwall is within the Inner Murray, Firth area of Highlands and Isles Enterprise, and businesses and communities in Dingwall are able to access the full range of support from Highlands and Isles Enterprise. Since 2013, High has invested around £1 million in companies in the Dingwall area to support 219 full-time equivalent jobs and safeguard 106 full-time equivalent jobs over a range of sectors. Over the same period, High has also provided a £2.46 million research and development grant and £90,000 Smart Scotland support for Inside Biometrics, a Dingwall-based company.
David Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister will be familiar with the award-winning Inside Biometrics facility in Dingwall, which is developing an innovative Kia Smart product which will be life-changing for people with diabetes. The company are looking to expand the production capacity, and this may create a substantial number of new jobs. but the company are looking for further advice, guidance and assistance from the Scottish Government for this major and significant expansion. Will the Minister agree to meet me to help bring this project to fruition?
Minister.
Dave Stewart, who I recognise takes strong interest in this issue, the Inside Biometrics are account managed by High, and High is closely engaged with the company and has provided both financial and advisory assistance to support the company to grow their business. I do recognise their award-winning company, and a very excellent one indeed. High has already provided, a £2.5 million research and development grant, which I referred to in my original answer. I am aware that Inside Biometrics have plans to expand their operations in Scotland. Indeed, I was contacted by Sally Siani, the owner, following the Life Sciences Awards, in which Dave Stewart refers to, and in which Inside Biometrics were award winners. And officials in High are remaining closely engaged with the company to explore every option to help support their growth. I visited the company last year myself and was hugely impressed by their technology. I've accepted an invitation to meet with Inside Biometrics in the near future to discuss how the Scottish Government can continue to support the company with its development plans. But I'm, of course, happy to meet Mr. Stewart to see if there's anything he has to suggest that we could help the company with.
Question for Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the latest Fraser of Allender economic commentary, which warns that indicators of Scottish consumer confidence are more negative than that of the UK as a whole.
Cabinet Secretary Keith Brown.
The latest Fraser of Allender Institute's economic commentary provides a timely update on the Scottish economy, and the report shows that consumer sentiment, as Brian Whittle has mentioned, has weakened in Scotland, but it's also done so in the UK since the EU referendum. The findings highlight the risks to Scotland's economic outlook following the EU referendum, as heightened uncertainty and rising inflation are forecast to weigh on household incomes and consumption. By far the biggest threat to Scotland's economy is a hard Brexit, which threatens to cost our economy, according to the same Fraser of Allender Institute, around £11 billion a year by 2030 and cost the country 80,000 jobs over a decade.
Brian Whittle.
Thank the Minister for that answer. Perhaps the Minister can explain to the Chamber why the Scottish economy is lagging behind the UK economy in a range of economic indicators. We have lower employment, higher inactivity, lower consumer confidence, lower annual pay growth, lower productivity and lower GDP growth. Why is Scotland falling behind under the party that claims to be stronger for Scotland? And I wonder if there's something distracting you from the day job.
Cabinet Secretary.
I think the member will be aware, of course, of the nature of the impact of the price of oil on the Scottish economy and the fact that would have a disproportionate effect on the Scottish economy as opposed to the wider UK economy. The member asked, though, what my response is. My response is to go out and try and attract more jobs. That's very important for the Scottish economy. I see today there are 300 new jobs being announced by Genpak in Glasgow. Digital solutions, risk management, following a contribution from Scottish Enterprise. 300 jobs because it's a new European centre in Glasgow. That's extremely important, and that's what we should do. It's part of my job title in terms of jobs. And also, the member mentions different economic indicators. Of course, there are other indicators which tell a different story. In terms of youth unemployment in Scotland, we have the second lowest in Europe, with only Germany having a better outcome. We also have very good numbers in terms of female employment, and the same employment rate, despite that oil impact, as the rest of the UK. So I think that does show real progress. And lastly, on confidence, which he mentions, again, in today's times, if you look at the Scottish Technology Industry Survey, 78% said that they were optimistic in Scotland, or very optimistic for this year. So I think we should try, difficult though it might be, to accentuate the positive, to see the things that we're doing well, of course to note the challenges, but try and do more of what we're doing well, and that's the best response we can have to the economic challenges which Brexit presents for us.
Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Being part of the UK hasn't done much for Scottish national self-confidence over generations. Can the Cabinet Secretary please tell us what the impact of the alleged union dividend has been on Scotland, given that since 1900 we have had the lowest rate of population growth of any country on earth?
Cabinet Secretary.
I could tell him if I was able to identify a union dividend, but I'm afraid that I can't see a union dividend. And more than that, the price of the union. If you think about the recession, the huge recession that we went through, with a recession caused by failures of the UK under the UK in terms of the banking and financial system. Of course, there were global elements to that, but there is no question that the regulation of the banking system was inept. And it was crucial that they did look after that. And the consequences for Scotland, and by which I mean individuals and companies in Scotland, of that recession were huge. So the UK has to accept its share of responsibilities. I'm accepting the Scottish Government's share of responsibility for the condition of the Scottish economy. After all, it was a Conservative MSP that said that the UK still holds all the major levers in the case of the Scottish economy. They've got to take responsibility as well.
Jackie Bailey.
Isn't the truth, Cabinet Secretary, that the same Fraser of Allender report noted that a second independence referendum is likely to act, and I quote, as a further headwind for many businesses and potential investors? Isn't it also the truth, Cabinet Secretary, that the UK market is worth four times that of Europe to the Scottish economy, so the impact has the potential to be much greater than leaving the European Union?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think it is true to say that, as I've mentioned already, the Fraser of Allender Institute identifies and quantifies the effect of the hard Brexit, which has been mentioned. £11 billion a year by 2030, 80,000 jobs over a decade. And it is interesting to me that Jackie Bailey decides not to even mention that, when even in the report that she cites, the institute that she refers to, they say that these are going to be the impacts, not a word about Labour, about these impacts, huge impacts on the Scottish economy. And I would say, in relation to the point about the recession we've just come through, it was the actions of the Scottish Government by investment in public infrastructure works which helped to mitigate the worst effects for that and has helped, it helped us to recover more quickly. Those actions are very important in sustaining the economy, and I think it would be useful if members could acknowledge that, but also if the Labour Party could acknowledge the effects of Brexit, which is very serious, £11 billion a year, 80,000 jobs, which they've failed to do on many occasions up to this time.
And Dean Lockhart.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary asked about the union dividend. I would point him to the Scottish Government's own numbers that last year, the GERS numbers, showed a £15 billion union dividend. The Fraser of Allender Institute also highlighted that since the SNP came to power, Scotland's economy has grown by an average of only 0.7% a year over the past 10 years. That is less than a third of Scotland's long-term economic growth. This underperformance has nothing to do with oil, nothing to do with Brexit. Does the Cabinet Secretary think that this underperformance over 10 years of SNP government is acceptable?
Cabinet Secretary.
I don't know. I can imagine businesses out with this chamber listening to somebody say, talking about economics, that the rate of growth in Scotland has got nothing to do with oil, thinking, how do you even start to respond to a point like that? So it's quite obvious to me that there's not the basic understanding of the Scottish economy implicit in the question. It's also true that I didn't raise the union dividend. Somebody else raised it, and I responded to that point in the way that I did. So I think it's what's very important in relation to this is to make sure that we do the right things through the economy. Martin Gibson for Aberdeen Asset Management said, Martin Gilbert said that we should look through the fog and try and see where the opportunities are. I've just mentioned 300 jobs, not a word of joy or congratulation from any opposition parties, but 300 new jobs coming to Glasgow. Not a word about the increased confidence in the Scottish Technology Industry Survey. These are important measures for Scotland. And of course, we have to recognise the challenges I've mentioned many times, productivity, internationalisation, exports. I recognise those challenges and I'm trying to take action to address them. But perhaps sometimes, surely, some of the opposition parties could acknowledge the strengths of the Scottish economy, even if it's just to try and encourage them so that we can all get the benefit from increased economic activity in Scotland.
And Mike Rumbles.
The Minister said he couldn't identify any union dividend. Could he identify a union dividend in his case with the Royal Marines for the protection of the whole of the United Kingdom together, and in my case, the Army? Would he accept that there is a union dividend in our defence? Approach to defence.
Sort of related, Cabinet Secretary. Briefly, Cabinet Secretary.
Once again, I just can't understand the lack of information or experience. If you look at the defence footprint in Scotland over recent years, what we have seen, well, maybe you don't think it's relevant, regiments actually on the frontline service being merged, people being handed their P45 when they're in active service, reducing basing cuts, reducing numbers in Scotland. Now, he would know this if he talked to some of the local authorities who are trying to wrestle with the latest round of basing cuts. For example, Fort George or Glencorse, a barracks which has had millions of pounds of investment, is going to be closed. I mean, the actual lack of understanding or knowledge of the question which Mike Rumble shows that he has no understanding of the defence activities here in Scotland. And perhaps before he asks a question like that, he should do a bit of homework next time.
Question number five, Richard Leonard.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it last met representatives of the Scottish Investment Bank.
Cabinet Secretary Keith Brown.
The Scottish Investment Bank is a division of Scottish Enterprise. Officials from Scottish Government, officials from Scottish Government met with representatives of the Scottish Investment Bank on Monday, the 20th of March.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer? What?
Order, please. Order. Richard Leonard.
Thanks. What guidance has the Scottish Government issued to the Scottish Investment Bank on the requirements that need to be satisfied for lending to companies or taking out equity stakes in companies regarding its stated goal of inclusive growth and so good trade union and industrial relations, the standard of employment contracts and the gender pay gap?
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Investment Bank, as I've said, is actually an arm of Scottish Enterprise, so they're fully appraised of the ambitions and the standards which the Scottish Government would like to see encouraged. And they've invested £52.4 million in 133 Scottish companies. They've helped companies leverage £277 million of private investment, and they've also invested £12.2 million in 13 SMEs through the Scottish Loan Fund. It is available to start-up, early-stage and expanding businesses. So those aims which we have in terms of the gender pay gap, in terms of inclusive growth, where everybody gets a chance to share in the opportunities for growth, are embedded in the work that Scottish Enterprise does, and they're well aware of the Scottish Government's standards and its ambitions in those regards.
Thank you. Apologies to members who waited patiently and to whom we did not reach. We'll now move on to the next item.